Welcome back to Let's Play Mass Effect Andromeda. Blind. I'm the RPG chick, and we're going to maybe finish reading Codex. Okay, so we've got something new under the journey so far. And then we've already read Andromeda species and plants and locations. So technology is next, and ships and vehicles. So let's see what's new here. Finding a home. Oh, these are subdirectories. The traitor on Kadara port. You work with Reyes Vidal and the resistance to free the traitor Ven Terev from Sloane Kelly's prison, sending him back to Aya for judgment. Oh, they think he's dead or something. No, he's not. A crew like no other. Callow. These are updates. You and Callow sometimes chat in your free time. Callow will take any excuse to talk about the Tempest. Tensions between Callow and Gil Brody have come to a head. You sided with Callow over Gil in the argument about the Tempest modifications. Callow is clearly glad that you understand how he feels. I'm not sure what in that is new, so I just read it all. Liam. Liam continues to confide about his hopes and doubts for the Initiative and people of Helios. You are becoming close friends. Lexi Tapero. Lexi is beginning to feel more comfortable in her role as Tempest Doctor. While you don't always see eye to eye, you both share a mutual respect of each other's abilities and an excitement for the unknown. Jal. Jal appreciates the time you spent with him, learning about him and his people. He's incredibly grateful for the part you played in rescuing the Moshai. He really likes that you took his advice in the Kit facility, and Gara don't hide their feelings. Your friendship will grow. Your relationship with Jal has evolved into something relaxed and friendly, but you have plenty more to teach each other. Okay. And under Andromeda species. Outlaws. Hostile rogue factions, both native and foreign, plagued the Helios cluster. This is new, I just saw that blink. Outlaws. Agent. Solarians have always operated at the very cutting edge of technology, believing that anything less is a waste of their capabilities. The Solarians who have chosen to become outlaws are no less exciting. Preferring to operate on the sidelines rather than leading an assault, they often deploy holographic decoys. While the decoy cannot damage an enemy, its kinetic barrier generator means that enemy targeting computers will register an impact when it's shot. This forces enemies, to divide their attention and allows the Solarian agent to flank or escape. Apex has attempted to research these decoys for larger scale deployment against the Cat, but have been unable to create a convincing thermal signature. Meanwhile, it can be expected that these Solarian agents will continue to refine their work. Oh goody. The Collective. Few verifiable reports of the Collective exist beyond Kadara Port. They claim the Collective is a spy network of Milky Way outlaws and N'Gara who use blackmail, espionage, smuggling, and hacking to gain leverage on Kadara. The Collective is said to be led by the Charlatan. No reliable data is available on this individual's identity, but the Charlatan has been quietly amassing influence since the Hyperion arrived in Andromeda. Those who cross the Charlatan are dealt with ruthlessly. Intercepted transmissions show that the outcasts consider the Collective's growing power a threat to their own position. The outcasts' focus has shifted from ferrying Nexus trade convoys to arms deals, putting them on a war footing. The Collective's response has been less public, but many outcast supporters have lost their fortunes or disappeared without a trace. You know what the cigarette-smoking man says? Nothing disappears without a trace. So I'm really missing the narrator that we had in Mass Effect 1, 2, and 3. I gotta read everything myself, man. Outlaws. Berserker. Centuries ago in the Milky Way, Krogan Berserkers served a key role in the Krogan Rebellions as frontal assault forces that cleared enemy dreadnoughts and besieged fortified positions. The battle cry of the famed Ravank Berserker Company was so distinctive and psychologically effective that it was often used in propaganda broadcasts. Today, Krogan who have joined outlaw bands claim to have revived Berserker tactics. Wielding powerful flak cannons, they bombard positions to intimidate enemies into breaking their line before closing in. When provoked, a berserker goes into the blood rage that gives them their name, losing higher brain functions and the ability to feel pain while unleashing devastating strikes that can snap an enemy's spine in one blow. Outlaw's Saboteur. Most of the cited outlaw forces are composed of forces from the Milky Way, but many Angara have also joined them, either out of disillusionment with the Resistance or their own personal glory. This has been heralded with fascination by Nexus social xenopsychologists, who claim it demonstrates universal values and goals between sentient life, and concern by Apex, who now have to contend with outlaws who have expert knowledge of the Helios Cluster. The light armor and weapons of Angaran outlaws have been fatally deceptive to many Apex squads. When necessary, the Angara act as saboteurs, using their innate control over electromagnetism to drain enemy shield capacitors and boost their own equipment. With combatants suddenly vulnerable, they are easy prey for the saboteur or their allies. Hydra. The strange technologies of the Helios Cluster offer many outlaw and exile groups opportunity rather than scientific mystery. With access to black market salvage, remnant technology and stolen gear from the Andromeda Initiative, some have crafted non-standard but highly effective battle mech suits nicknamed Hydras. Most Hydra are armed with a chain gun and a devastating laser-guided RPG volley, pinning down enemies before bombarding them with heavy fire. Unapproved jump jet designs and a mass-lowering Element Zero core assist in ground clearance or leaping at a target. The sheer weight and impact of the Hydra unit can crush armies or force them to fall back. Apex officially classifies a Hydra unit as a Priority Zero threat, though unofficial communications often use the acronym BFM. Okay. Sloane Kelly. Before her appointment as Director of Nexus Security, Sloane served in the Alliance but was discharged after punching a superior officer for bureaucratic bullshit, quote-unquote. Some of the Initiative's senior leadership had concerns about Sloane's temper, but Director Jean Garson admired Sloane's passion and believed her frank attitude and resourcefulness would ultimately keep the Nexus safer than someone who ran things by the book. Well, she was wrong. I need a drink here. Jaren Tan felt differently. Relations between Sloane and the new Initiative director, while never good, quickly deteriorated during the uprising. Sloane was vehemently against using the Krogan against the mutineers and took it personally when the director went behind her back to make a deal with Clan Nakmore. Upon learning of the director's intervention, Sloane switched sides and joined the rebellion. Although the uprising ultimately failed, Sloane gained legendary status among the exiles and amassed a group of followers called the Outcasts. After leaving the Nexus, Sloane traveled across Helios to Kadara Port, where she defeated an invading Ket force and set herself and the Outcasts up as the ruling power on the planet. Reyes Vidal. Like many exiles, Reyes Vidal's screening interviews and personal records were corrupted during the mutiny on a Nexus. Internal staffing emails show he was a pilot assigned to Shuttle N-503, callsign Anubis, but beyond that, very little is known about Reyes's life before arriving in Andromeda. Since the Nexus uprising, Reyes has made a name for himself as a smuggler working out of Kadara Port. While most exiles on Kadara feel pressured to choose between joining the Outcasts or the Collective to be successful, Reyes proudly claims to be a free agent, and even does jobs for the Angaran Resistance. Despite being known as a reliable smuggler who always gets the job done, Reyes is notoriously bad about paying his bar tabs, with the exception of Tartarus, where it's rumored he has worked out a deal with Kian, the owner. Anything else? Nope, that's it. Okay, planets and locations. Aya. We haven't read this one? Maybe it has update? I don't know. I'll just read it. Aya is an anomaly in the Helios cluster, a lush planet where a remnant site appears to be active. It is a sanctuary for the Angara, the only known sentient species local to Helios, and guarded fiercely against outsiders. This is helped by Aya's position relative to Helios's black hole, whose gravitational lensing effect makes Aya harder to detect. The Scourge also makes the approach to Aya extremely dangerous for untrained pilots. Scans indicate numerous wrecks lost in the Scourge nearby, picked clean by Angaran salvagers. Aya is also the headquarters of the Angaran resistance movement against the Ket, whose leaders advise Aya's planetary governor, Paran Shai. Director Tan is ordered that Aya is not only to be considered sovereign territory, but a military power. While the Tempest and its crew are allowed to visit peacefully, the Nexus is advising extreme caution to other potential visitors and ordering the distribution of early contact guidelines. With relations warming between the Initiative and the Angara, diplomatic overtures continue. This is probably the update. The Initiative is opening an embassy on Aya with Paran Shai's approval, while extending invitations to Angaran diplomats and scientists to tour the Nexus. Our cultural exchange is beginning several cooperative programs intended to foster better understanding between the various Milky Way species and the Angara. What else we got? Anything else? Kadara. Kadara was of great interest to the Andromeda Initiative after it appeared on long-range surveys. Seemingly abundant liquid water and an oxygen-mixed atmosphere made it a strong candidate for a settlement, earning it the designation Habitat 4. Closer-range surveys now reveal that Kadara's water sources are tainted and unpotable. Of greater concern is the large settlement known as Kadara Port. Reportedly once a trade port for the Angara, it has been adopted by exiles, pirates, and mercenaries who use it as a staging ground. Kadara Port is considered a rogue state by the Nexus, given its strong ties to the exiles, and Initiative personnel are advised to keep their distance. Apex reports that Kadara Port is currently contested by two factions, the Pirate Outcasts, led by former Nexus security official Sloane Kelly, and a more mysterious group of spies and smugglers, broadly known as the Collective. Okay, now we're into category. We have not gone into this yet. Technology. Information on technology used by the Initiative and other advanced civilizations in Helios. Exploration tools. Device is used to survey, investigate, and map a new galaxy. Scanner. Planetary surveying, especially for a potential settlement, involves meticulous scanning. However, there has been little pressure to improve planetary scanners. In its search for a better solution for its pathfinders, the Andromeda Initiative began with hardware salvaged from both platforms and software developed by the Solarian STG. With artificial intelligence support, Initiative scientists developed a fast, accurate sampling system, codenamed Panoptes, I guess. I'm not sure how to say that. Linking it to the quantum computing power of an AI which can produce multiple analyses and predictive models in seconds. They created an omni-tool mounted scanner that completes accurate surveys in moments instead of weeks. For typical scanning, the Panoptes system uses a transmitted accelerator mass spectrometer, or TRAMS. This creates a snapshot of an object's components, atomic weight, and radioactivity, and allows me to produce more in-depth analysis. For biological materials, the Panoptes system switches to an electrospray ionization system so plants or animals can be scanned without causing radiation damage. Field repurposing. With limited cargo space aboard the ARCs for specialized gear and facing unknown dangers in Andromeda, the Initiative's philosophy is adapt to succeed. Colonists are required to have a wide variety of skills. Equipment and weapons are expected to perform multiple functions. However, this adaptability is fueled by non-renewable resources like ammunition, metagel, and power cells. Knowing they would not be readily available in Andromeda, in an emergency, the Initiative's omni-tools can recover and repurpose appropriate resources to serve a similar function. Liquid coolant allows weapon heat sinks to be reused, organic compounds can be refined into metagel, and so on. When these resources are available, the user is alerted via an interface between the user scanner and their HUD. Jump jets. Once proprietary hardware for Turian Special Forces, Initiative armor comes with jump jets as standard. These jets allow a user to make extremely high jumps or hover for several seconds. All colonists are trained in their operation to evade predators or environmental hazards, obtain resources, or conduct maintenance in high places safely. The jump jet itself consists of a helium-3 microthruster with a tungsten hafnium carbide casing. A gyroscopic element zero core functions to keep the user orientated in flight and lower their mass when hovering, keeping fuel expenditure down. Hard-coded safety features prevent continuous operation of jump jets to avoid injuring the user or melting their equipment. Yeah, that wouldn't be a good thing. Technology, consumable resources. While Andromeda Initiative gear and weaponry is designed to be as versatile as possible, extraordinary circumstances sometimes arise. Pathfinders and scout forces often turn to less orthodox resources to ensure they survive hostile conditions. Adrenaline is a nickname for a prototype Omnigel OST package. When deployed, it bypasses Omnitool safeties to minifacture, small-scale manufacture, new heat sinks, and provide a temporary but powerful boost to armor. A shield capacitor immediately overlocks a user's shields, bringing them to full power and giving them a boost. This boost is unstable, however, and will be lost the next time the shield is breached. A life support pack boosts the environmental management systems of a user's hard suit, enabling them to cope with environmental hazards for a longer period. Special ammunition packs apply a variety of effects to weapons fire. Incendiary ammo coats projectiles in thermite pastes as they are fired. The paste adheres to and burns through armor. Cryo ammo uses Bose-Einstein condensate to freeze an enemy or slow them. Disruptor ammo projectiles carry an electrical charge that damages enemy hard suit systems. The Cobra RPG package uses a volatile solution of Omnigel to manufacture a short-lived but extremely dangerous projectile. Launched from an Omnitool, it hits with the same explosive power as a portable rocket launcher. Sweet. And speaking of which, Omnitools. Omnitools are handheld devices that combine a computer microframe, sensor analysis pack, and manufacturing fabricator. Versatile and reliable, an Omnitool can be used to analyze and adjust the functionality of most standard equipment, including weapons and armor, from a distance. The holographic haptic interface also functions as a communication device. With sufficient Omnigel or other raw materials, usually converted from salvaged light alloys, plastics, or ceramics, an Omnitool fabrication module can flash forge small three-dimensional objects or emergency suit patches. This allows quick repairs or modifications in the field. The Andromeda Initiative's Omnitools are designed for reliability and efficient recycling of materials. Pathfinder Omnitools take design inspiration from the models used by Solarian Intelligence Services, prioritizing the computer microframe to allow lag-free scanning and AI support. Research and development. New designs and advancements in technology. Materials. Crafting new weapons, armor, and equipment requires a variety of materials. Though there are strange new isotopes and ores in Andromeda, our scientists have identified familiar elements. Heavy metals such as iron, cadmium, and nickel are used in construction and heavy manufacturing. Their density makes them useful for armor components and ammunition blocks. Many light metals, including silicon, beryllium, magnesium, and aluminum, are resistant to corrosion and invaluable for computer components, heat sinks, and high conductive electrical wiring, while lithium has both engineering and medical applications. Titanium, a transition metal, is eagerly sought after for starship construction. Vanadium improves steel quality and is used by the aerospace industry. Notable metals, including platinum, copper, and iridium, are rare and valuable in the Milky Way. They are often used in high-quality electronics or machine parts that require high precision. Minerals like graphite, used to manufacture carbon nanotubes and carbon fiber and fluorite for high-precision scientific lenses, are more common but equally useful. The initiative pays well for more hazardous materials. Uranium is used in weaponry and nuclear-powered facilities, While Element Zero has applications in multiple fields, heavy industry, starship engines, jump jet components, or even as an ingredient in many advanced medicines, to name but a few. Weapon and armor mods. Andromeda Initiative equipment is designed to be modular and adaptable to any situation. Weapons and armor in particular are built with the understanding that they will be customized multiple times in the field over their operational lifetime. Gun modifications can be purchased from appropriate locations or recovered in the field. Each weapon's targeting computer also contains an adaptive integration VI that analyzes a mod on installation, adjusts the weapon's balance, heatsink requirements, and ammunition block accordingly, and sends a list of any additional components to the user's OmniTool for manufacturing. The process typically takes only a few minutes. We now know that some remnant technology functions in a similar fashion. The highly advanced modules recovered from remnant sites can be integrated into existing armor pieces. Their ability to fuse in this way has earned them the nickname Fusion Mods, though this is hotly debated in the Nexus Tech Labs. The full capabilities of these fusion mods is still being researched. While they offer impressive benefits, successfully integrating them with our technology often requires a trade-off in some capabilities while vastly improving others. The user is advised to choose their fusion mods with care. Augmentations. With many material components in Andromeda, while many material components in Andromeda are familiar, we have also discovered rarer and more valuable materials attributable to the exposure to the Scourge or mysterious alien technology. These augmentation materials are used in research and development to craft powerful, specialized items. Augmentations are essential to support weapon or gear combinations that would be impossible to build with conventional materials. Some augmentations are built by traders, or sold by traders, rather, but the highest quality augmentations require careful research. Once completed, the augmentation's profile is used to recognize additional examples of that augmentation out in the field. And the Research Center. A research center is a research and development platform normally assigned to outposts and some selective initiative starships. Advanced manufacturing capability, small-scale manufacture, and information processing allows the research center to develop new technology and build it almost on the spot. They are also used to build powerful augmentations that enhance the capability of equipment. Given the initiative's current limitations, bandwidth, and resource allocations to current research centers is carefully monitored. The Nexus underlines the importance of new discoveries by rewarding scans and information gathered via a points system. Currently referred to as Research Data Points, or RD, these can be used for access time at research centers to discover or create new blueprints. Okay. Settling Helios. Technology to build a new home from the ground up. Oh my. Technology. Charting Andromeda. Charting the Andromeda Galaxy for habitable planets presents a unique challenge. Observation is limited by light, and given Andromeda's distance, any observations from the Milky Way are 2.5 million years out of date. Enough time for a planet to have altered irrevocably. As we've seen, initial attempts to identify settlement sites are made by obtaining Asari astronomical surveys and running them through predictive models, but Jane Garson was unwilling to risk thousands of colonists without solid information. Eventually, the initiative obtained promising data from Quarian explorers who claimed to have found a Geth array on the fringes of the Perseus Veil. This array was supposedly built from three mass relays using sensors in the combined relay corridor as a form of FTL telescope to observe dark space beyond the galactic rim. Why the Geth expended so much effort to study dark space is not known. They're probably looking for the Reapers. Amongst these observations were near-contemporary surveys of Andromeda. Well, when our predictive models confirmed them, within an acceptable margin, the initiative was able to begin identifying golden worlds. Communications and QEC. Communications have always been a concern for interstellar colonists. Trade, defense, and political representation depend on reliable lines of communication. The most sophisticated method is quantum entanglement communication, or QEC. This utilizes a pair of particles that are linked on a quantum level. Any effect on one particle is mirrored instantaneously by the other, regardless of the distance between. Pathfinder implants use miniaturized QECs to remain in contact with their AI partners. However, manufacturing these particle pairs is a delicate and difficult process, especially with resources limited in Helios. Long-term, the Andromeda Initiative plans to establish a comm relay network transmitting data between buoys linked by mass-free corridors of space. The Scourge has hampered these efforts. In the meantime, Initiative starships act like maritime mail packets, carrying secure data packages that transmit to approved colony receivers once they're in range. The transmissions are limited by the ship's data storage and the capability of receivers, but improvements are ongoing, and I need a drink. Okay. Forward stations. Automated forward stations are part of the initial wave of exploration or colonist deployment. They contain valuable research caches for explorers to resupply, repair stations for vehicles, and ground-penetrating sensors to identify mineral deposits. Their presence improves the chances of a planet being considered viable. Yes, with each one you do, it becomes a little more viable. Each one you discover, anyway. Or deploy, yeah. When a planet is seriously considered for settlement or a survey is ongoing, forward stations are seeded into orbit via automated barges. Once summoned to a designated zone, forward stations descend and anchor themselves on the ground, becoming valuable landmarks. Not benchmarks. Most scout rovers have forward station connectivity, allowing them to be summoned to the stations. Current resource constraints mean that, in theory, only Pathfinders have official sanction to call down forward stations. In reality, reports show that enterprising colonists or unscrupulous scavengers have been known to hack the signals to raid the stations for supplies. Very naughty. Mining. Without a steady supply of minerals and metallic ores, the Initiative's engineering capabilities grind to a halt. With plans so far off schedule, it's even more important to gather resources whenever possible. On the ground, Pathfinder scanners and ground-penetrating radar of forward stations assist in locating resources for immediate harvest or for colonists beginning their own mining operations. In space, Initiative starships can pinpoint resources from orbit. Each ship is equipped with probes that contain both a sensor beacon and robotic drones that can harvest at least a percentage of any deposits quickly. The Nexus has rallied an asteroid mining. The Nexus has relied on asteroid mining for the raw materials to support the construction efforts, which yield heavy metals and platinum. The Scourge is a rich resource of Element Zero, but the hazardous conditions destroy most robotic telepresence, making it an expensive pursuit. Most prospectors look on nearby planets for jettisoned rock and debris from the Scourge, which often contain ESO deposits. Technology. Terraforming. Terraforming is the science of making planets more viable for life. Soft terraforming involves the introduction of bacteria or ocean algae to bind toxic gases or adjust a hostile ecology. Hard terraforming is often conducted on arid planets with a thin atmosphere, using the impact of a comet or asteroid to warm the planet before introducing microbial life. This process can take centuries. Terraforming even a barren planet often involves significant financial and ethical hurdles. The Andromeda Initiative has the capability for terraforming if necessary, but is limited by the time frames involved. The Golden Worlds surveyed from the Milky Way were intended to support quick colonist deployment, with second-tier candidates identified for potential terraforming later. If the remnant vault on Eos is intended for terraforming, as evidence shows, its function is unprecedented. The ability to affect change on a global scale in such a short time defies our understanding of planetary science. The vault on Aya not only confirms that the remnant builders used their technology to terraform planets, but that the vaults are part of a massive network across Helios Cluster with a central control point dubbed Meridian. The existence of Meridian places the vaults and their operation in a larger context. A species capable of engineering on a cluster-wide scale would not need to terraform worlds to survive. Though reactivating the vaults results in an environment agreeable to Milky Way species, it is entirely possible that their renewed viability is a means rather than an end. And cryogenic stasis. For many species, early long-range exploration relied on cryogenic stasis. Without modern FTL capability or long-distance transit methods like mass relays, the distances involved in space travel meant that most crews would die of old age before reaching their destination. Cryogenic stasis gradually lowers the body's temperature enough to slow its vital functions, but not low enough for damaging ice crystals to form. Before the pod generates a mass effect, a stasis field that suspends both the individual and the interior environment in the pod. Contrary to depictions in popular media, the individual is not conscious of time passing. From most travelers' perspective, they lie down in the pod only to be awoken moments later. Stasis failure, while regrettably common for early expeditions, has been vastly improved over the years. Even in the event of catastrophic system failure, multiple monitoring VIs and fail-safes are in place to initiate an emergency wake-up. And finally, tech and bionics. The science behind abilities that seemingly defy the laws of physics. Element Zero, or EZO, also known as EZO, the rare material known as Element Zero, generates a field when subjected to electrical current, which raises or lowers the mass of all objects within it. This mass effect forms the basis of modern technology, from weapons and manufacturing to enabling faster-than-light travel. Element Zero is generated when solid matter, such as a planet, is affected by the energy of a star going supernova. The material is common in the asteroid debris that orbits neutron stars and pulsars, though mining such regions is extremely hazardous and requires significant investment. Various isotopes of Element Zero have been identified, though the rarest have only been observed in laboratory conditions. Surveys of the Helios cluster suggested the region is rich in Element Zero, which was a deciding factor in the Andromeda Initiative's decision to settle there. Without EZO, the Initiative's technology would quickly become obsolete. FTL Drive. A starship travels faster than light using an Element Zero drive core. In special relativity, an object approaching light speed effectively gains in mass until it would take infinite energy to propel it. But a negative electrical current running through an EZO drive core lowers the starship's mass, allowing it to travel at FTL speeds. I guess it's lowering it to where we weigh as much as light does, which is nothing. Motive force is provided by the ship's thrusters, chemical rockets, commercial fusion torch, or a military anti-proton drive, in addition to the FTL drive core. Without thrusters, the ship has no ability to move. Starship drive cores build up a static charge during operation and must be discharged periodically. Otherwise, the core discharges into the ship itself with catastrophic results. The Initiative's drive cores, intended for long-term voyages, are designed to recycle or reduce static buildup. Mass effect fields. Element Zero can increase or decrease the mass of a volume of space-time when subjected to an electrical current. With a positive current, the mass is increased. With a negative current, mass is decreased. You know, I don't know if they ever went into such detail on the currents in the other mass effect. I don't recall. The stronger the current, the greater the magnitude of the dark energy mass effect. In space, low mass fields allow FTL travel and inexpensive surface to orbit transit. High mass fields create artificial gravity and push space debris away from vessels. In manufacturing, low mass fields permit the creation of evenly blended alloys, while high mass compaction creates dense, sturdy construction materials. The Andromeda Initiative's technology relies heavily on mass effect fields from reduced mass supply drops for outposts to the impressive long-range drive cores on the arcs. Technology. Artificial intelligence. While a virtual intelligence is little more than a sophisticated interactive operating system, an artificial intelligence is a self-aware computing system capable of learning and independent decision-making. Creating an AI requires adaptive code, a long education, and a specialized quantum computer known as a blue box. In the Milky Way, artificial intelligence is considered a threat to galactic civilization. The Geth, synthetic life forms who turn on their quarian creators, not without good cause, are often used as an example of the destructive capability of rogue AI and those who attempt to create AI without strict Citadel Council oversight, or subject to sanctions or even arrest. Alright, so we didn't know the truth back then because we pretty much found out most of the truth in Mass Effect 3. Alec Ryder's research papers claim that experiential separation is the root of conflict between organic and synthetic life, that an AI sharing this experience of its creator would have no desire to rebel. My connection to your Pathfinder implant and physiology make me the first iteration of this new approach to AI. And finally, technology, biotics. Biotics are rare individuals with the ability to create and manipulate Mass Effect fields. Given the correct implants and careful training, a biotic can raise defensive barriers, yank opponents off their feet, or shred an enemy apart at the molecular level. A biotic gains these abilities after exposure to dust form element zero in utero or via secondary exposures at a young age. Though this often results in fatal cancer, roughly 10% of those exposed develop element zero nodules along their nervous system. Once activated by the body's electrical impulses, these nodules allow the biotic to create Mass Effect fields, though most need a neural implant to wield them effectively. Really? So our biotics, 90% die? Are we making these biotics on purpose now? Because 90% of them are dying of cancer. Some species, like the Asari, are naturally biotic, but human biotics are still relatively rare, and many view them with suspicion. The Andromeda Initiative has proven attractive to biotic applicants. And you know what? There can't be that many ships and vehicles. We're just going to read this. And we'll be caught up with Codex, believe it or not. The vessels and transports that make exploration possible. Here's a bunch of crap. Ark Parchero. I never even heard of that. Ark Parchero is the Andromeda Initiative's designated vessel for transporting Solarian colonists to the new galaxy. Mirroring the design of its human counterpart, Hyperion, Ark Parchero can accommodate 20,000 passengers and crew in cryogenic stasis. Parchero's development was plagued by early delays and disagreements between its senior crew and the Initiative's design team. The Solarian penchant for constantly pushing the boundaries of technology was often at odds with the realities of budgets and time constraints. At one point, it was calculated that if every vital and necessary improvement suggested by the Solarian contingent was incorporated into the Parchero's design, its launch would have been delayed until 2204 at the soonest. That's what we, in software development is known as feature creep, adding more and more features and improved things so that the thing never ends up actually being finished. After considerable negotiation and debate, a compromise was reached, and Ark Parchero departed the Milky Way in 2185 in the initial wave of settlers under the command of Captain Lumont Hager. ND1 Nomad. Seeking a suitable scout rover, the Andromeda Initiative purchased a promising but rejected design from the Systems Alliance military. The issue quickly became apparent on rough terrain. Without the bracing of heavy armor, the chassis was prone to twist. The Initiative have already developed lightweight but strong memory alloys, which solved the problem. The resulting ND1 Nomad exchanges heavy armaments for superior agility. The rover has a tripartite element zero core, which allows fine control over acceleration and a more modest helium-3 fuel cost for its microthrusters. Its lighter weight enables both six-wheel drive and four-wheel drive, and four-wheel steering for hazardous surfaces. Fitting the initiative's adaptive philosophy, the Nomad can be customized with appropriate camouflage or initiative colors. When necessary, during long-haul exploration, the rover contains an emergency shelter. It can produce potable water from its hydrogen-oxygen fuel cells, though scientists recommend adding a flavor pack to it first. Really? You can have a shelter in there with water. Huh. The Tempest. The Tempest is a survey ship designed for long-range, long-term exploration under a Pathfinder's command. Its lightweight and efficient design allow it to operate with a small crew and minimal resources. Built by the Andromeda Initiative, the Tempest makes use of several once proprietary technologies, including an IES stealth system originally developed by the Systems Alliance. Many of these systems were permitted on the condition that the Tempest only operate in the Andromeda Galaxy. Interesting. The Tempest engine is a variation on the Ark's Odyssey drives that allow long-term operation, capturing a percentage of the static buildup in capacitors. The recycled electrical charge powers several of the Tempest's onboard systems. As a Pathfinder vessel, the Tempest has research and development facilities, laboratories, and a well-appointed meeting space to accommodate dignitaries anticipating any potential first contact scenarios. Ark Lucinia. So we don't know about two of these arcs. Well, these aren't in alphabetical order. I don't know what order this is following. Constructed in orbit around Piares in the Asari home system Parnitha, Ark Lucinia is named after a kingdom of wealth and learning in Asari mythology. She is built to the same specifications as her sister Ark Hyperion, with her internal modifications to accommodate Asari social preferences, and captained by Elonis Atandra. This is pretty cool, because we haven't really heard that much about these Arks, other than, you know, this is the Turian Ark, this is the Asari Ark. And they're all missing. The Andromeda Initiative was initially rejected as a human-driven boondoggle by many Asari investors, and the construction of the Lucinia was met with ridicule. However, the efforts drew the attention of several matriarchs who had assisted in previous attempts to send crewed missions to Andromeda, and their impassioned extranet addresses helped turn the tide of public opinion. At her departure ceremony, Ark Lucinia was officially blessed by the Atamna Politeia, an organization of Sierras high priestesses from across the Asari Republics. Ark Lucinia traveled to the Initiative rendezvous point in 2184 and left the Milky Way as part of the initial departure wave in 2185. Tempest, Odyssey Drive, Standard ship drive cores built up static electricity and require periodic discharge on a planet or at specialized facilities to prevent static from building to dangerous levels. With such suitable discharge points in dark space, the Odyssey drive core was developed for the Ark's long-haul journey to Andromeda. The Tempest drive core is an experimental small-scale variant based on the original design. The Odyssey out-galaxy distributed static sink drive core is designed to minimize static buildup and transfers the remaining charge to specially designed capacitors attached to the core. The recycled electricity is used to run ship systems, reducing power requirements and lowering heat generation. Cross galaxy, the Arcs gathered hydrogen using an electromagnetic ram scoop, converting it into protons with an ionizing laser. Proton collision in the Arcs fusion reactors provided power for their thrusters. The Tempest thrusters run on conventional helium-3, though initiative breakthroughs in fuel efficiency means their helium-3 requirements are drastically lowered. Tempest. Technology. The Tempest required a number of experimental technologies to accommodate the unique requirements of a Pathfinder team. Its planetary surface imaging, for example, uses photosensitive and radar LIDAR-emitting microsatellites that coordinate with the Tempest router back to SAM node. I then conduct simulated scientific and probability studies on the data before presenting the Pathfinder with a summarized analysis, typically in 0.5 seconds. That's way too long. You have to improve that. I can't wait that long. The Tempest computer network presented interesting challenges. As most Milky Way computer systems have anti-AI safeguards built in, the Tempest network had to be designed from scratch to accommodate my interaction with the ship's systems. Firmware bridges, inspired by studies into Geth networking technology, allow me to temporarily interact with and augment sensors, communications, and the ship's navigation array. Given the desire to reduce mass without sacrificing safety, the electrical charge from the Tempest capacitors is used to keep the ship stable via prototype piezoelectric vibration reduction, PVR technology. When the ship's superstructure is bent by vibrations, such as during atmospheric reentry or complex flight maneuvers, piezoelectric elements receive an electrical charge that bends bulkheads in the opposite direction, reducing vibrations and smoothing the ship's flight path. Tempest research capabilities. Pathfinders are often the first to encounter new potential threats or valuable technology. The Tempest is therefore equipped for sophisticated research and development in the field to support a vast turnaround of any necessary upgrades or analysis. Its research center syncs with the tech lab systems, giving insight into the capabilities of new materials and their potential applications. My connection to Arc Hyperion and the Nexus allows me to transfer data and latest discoveries from the scientist station there. Quantum computing enables multiple complex simulations to be run simultaneously, and new components or configurations can be tested virtually before they are built. Tempest Stealth System. In 2183, the Systems Alliance and the Turian Hierarchy co-developed the IES, Internal Emission Sink Stealth System, for small military frigates. It's unknown how the initiative acquired this system for its survey ships, as IES stealth technology is classified. Despite valid security certificates, no record of negotiations exists in the Nexus legal archives. An IES stealth system is designed to capture the heat and radiation emitted by all starships in refrigerated storage sinks, effectively removing the ship from sensors. Initiative starship systems are streamlined to emit less electromagnetic and particle radiation and to lower heat production. This reduces the amount of emissions to be stored. Additionally, breakthroughs in cryogenic research allow the storage sinks to be more effectively refrigerated, allowing longer stealth time before the sinks must be vented for safety. The Tempest can remain stationary in stealth for several hours or travel at FTL in silent running for shorter periods. Arcanitanus, hold on. I didn't mean to go over those. We got four left. Sweet. Arcanitanus was constructed in orbit around Eventon, a once lucrative mining planet in the Turian home system, Chebia. The Ark was named after legendary spacefarer Palex Natanus, who is believed to be the first Turian to travel through a mass relay. The Natanus is built to similar specifications as the Asari and human Arks, but with minor changes to accommodate her dextro-amino acid-based passengers. Natanus is captained by the renowned Dia Pritan of the Sixth Fleet. Like most economical ventures, Turian investors were turned onto the Andromeda Initiative by their clients, the Volus. The Turian hierarchy was intentionally kept in the dark to keep the initiative a private civilian project. Really? Surprised no, Volus here, though. Arc Natanus traveled to Initiative Rendezvous Point in 2184 and left the Milky Way as part of the initial departure wave in 2185. Ket Starships. The Ket utilize a variety of military aircraft, from agile dropships to enormous dreadnoughts. Closer inspection of Ket Starships, including several destroyed by the Scourge, has shown that they appear to be heavily biomimetic, while not organic. Ket takes strong design inspiration from living organisms. Air filtration electrical systems, and heat management mimic behavior seen in living creatures. The few KET engine cores available for study show that while the KET use element zero cores, their design is radically different. While in comparatively short-range environments, such as the Helios cluster, they function similarly to Milky Way drives, KET core drives are capable of gravitationally contracting space in front of the ship and shortening behind, creating an Alcubierre waveform that allows the ship to traverse longer distances quickly. This design feature compensates somewhat for the lack of short-range mass relay transport in Andromeda, though these drives are highly inefficient by comparison. However, it is clear we have only seen a small cross-section of KET starships, likely military vessels on long deployment. More scientifically advanced starships may exist elsewhere. Tempest Laboratories. The Tempest is equipped for long-range survey and scientific studies, which are carried out at the ship's two main labs. The biolab is equipped to hydroponically grow both Milky Way and Andromeda plant life for research or consumption. The plants also clean the ship's air and generate a modest amount of oxygen. Really? There's not that much space for many plants there to make a difference, I don't think. Sealed observation chambers are set up to study small fauna, sequence genetic material, or simulate bacterial growth in carefully controlled conditions. All biomatter entering or leaving the lab is subjected to additional quarantine measures. The tech lab is used for engineering and technical studies, spectral analysis using laser apparatus, and for analyzing the capabilities of discovered technology. New minerals or metals can be subjected to additional resistance testing before being used in the Tempest Research Center. Because of the potential volatility of new materials, the tech lab is equipped with heavy radiation shielding and can be sealed off in an emergency. And finally, Ark Hyperion. Ark Hyperion serves as the main vessel for carrying human settlers bound for Andromeda. Named after a Greek mythological figure associated with knowledge of celestial bodies, the Hyperion represents a breakthrough in intergalactic travel. Substantial money and resources were devoted to its construction, all privately funded by Jin Garson in the Andromeda Initiative. Built to withstand the rigors of nearly 2.5 million light-year voyage, the Hyperion is outfitted with Odyssey Drive Core technology, which allows the ship to make a 600-year voyage safely at FTL speeds. It features enough stasis pods to accommodate approximately 20,000 settlers and crew. Ark Hyperion left the Milky Way in 2185 as part of the initial wave of departures under the command of Captain Nozomi Dunn. Speaking of Dunn, we're done. Codex, no longer with a exclamation mark. Why does journal have an exclamation? Nexus. Oh, contagion. Speaking of Dunn, an initiative citizen with an incurable disease has been awakened from status. Track her down and return her to status stasis before the disease spreads. Meet with Dunn on Hyperion's habitation deck. Additional tasks. The Angara Initiative. Director Tan reports that the Angara have opened an embassy on Aya. Check in with the Initiative representatives there to make sure things go smoothly. I might go to Aya first, then, since we got two things now. So, I guess next is Nexus and Hyperion, then Aya, then Eos, and then on to Havarl. Completed missions. Yes, they're completed, so... Good. Journal. Still shows... Yeah, I don't know. It still says that, but we're done. There's nothing in there that has an exclamation point. Done, wow. Thanks so much, guys. We are complete for now. Well, until we add more stuff, it's going to be easy, though. Just going to be catching up with what new entries as they come in, more or less. But otherwise, yeah, done with Codex. Thanks so much for watching. Stay tuned for the next episode when we return to the Nexus. Oh, no. We return down to... What do you call it? This planet. Can't remember the name. Kadara.
Now orbiting Kadara.
Yeah. We got stuff to do. So yeah. So, to summarize, Kadara, Nexus and Hyperion, Aya, Eos, and then Havarl, finally. Thanks so much for watching. See you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.